So now today we will learn one very very interesting topic, that is classification in machine learning, right? And today I will discuss two algorithms, decision tree and k nearest neighbor algorithm together. But I will define the technical details of this algorithm first, then I will explain the mathematical details. So today we are going to perform this coding. Okay, so this type of coding today we are going to do, they are very simple to understand, but today we will do some comprehensive analysis also. Now you will understand how we can perform comprehensive analysis in case of machine learning. So let's start with the classification concept. Now, if anyone asks me this question, that is, what do you mean by classification? See, in the previous class, I was talking about supervised and unsupervised learning. So here I can say that classification algorithm comes under supervised learning. Now, I will give you one example of classification first. So the best example of the classification is, of classification algorithm is, say we are going to design a system that can detect spam emails, that is email spam detection comes under classification concept. So basically what happens in case of classification, the model is trained on the basis of millions of emails. Now, along with this email, we have to give some features of those emails. Feature of those email means whether there exist any sender details or not, whether there is any receiver details or not. So these are the some kind of features that is required for detecting any spam email. Now, after training the machine or after training our machine with this supervised classification algorithms, so what we need as a training component, the features and as well as information about the emails. And then what we will do, so whenever what it does, when the system is already ready for classification, then it just identifies whether a particular email is a spam or not. So whenever it receives a new email, it will check two classes, whether it is a spam email or whether it is a non-spam or not spam email, right? These are the two classes that here it is going to detect. So here the first point is, if you ask me this question, that what is the concept of classification? The very basic concept of classification is, classification will take some input values and map those input values to corresponding to some output values. Now, this concept, this mapping concept is very much important. But the important thing is, whenever I'm talking about regression problem, you find me stating the same definition, that is, it will map some input x to some output y. So the basic difference between classification and regression, we can say that the output values for regression problem will be the continuous values. Continuous values, value means it will be some kind of price, it will be some kind of salary, age of a person, something like that. So whenever it is dealing with continuous values as an output, then it will be a classical problem of regression. However, if it deals with some discrete values means, say, true or false value, or we can say that female or male, so this kind of output value we have, or in this case, in for our example, we have spam and not spam. So these are the kind of values that we can say that these are the discrete value. So whenever your output is in terms of discrete values, then we can say that this data set is used for classification purpose. So at the starting of this class, I have explained that one of the example of classification algorithm is email spam detection. So from here, you can understand that email spam detection means whether it is a spam or not spam. So the output value Y is a discrete value. So therefore, we will model this spam detection concept with the help of classification. Now, in case of classification, we can use many algorithms. So in machine learning, we have lots of algorithms that we can use. But while implementing those algorithms, we have some basic technical steps that we have to keep in mind. So I am just going to state one by one what are the steps we have. So as we know, we are dealing with Irish flower, and we know that what is the data set, means how the data set will look like. So for this classification problem solving, we have to perform some steps. The first step is we have to create the data set. But this portion is already done by us because we know that how to extract data set from UCI machine learning repository, or we can extract data set from Kaggle also. So we know from which machine learning repository we have to access in order to get the data. So the first part is over. Now what is the second part? Second part is we have to build the model. So building a model, we know that what is the purpose. Today we are going to build a model for classification. So the second step is we have to learn, that is how to build a model. Then the third step is we have to train the model. So whenever I was stating this spam detection example, I have already stated that the first responsibility is we have to train the machine with some millions of emails and with their features or with their parameters. So features as well as class levels, millions of information are used to train the particular machine. So this is how we can train the model. So this is our third step. So we will learn how to write the code for training a model. Then the fourth step is we have to make the prediction. So actually, email spam detection, it will comes under the concept of prediction. Prediction means whatever new emails are coming, we have to predict that they are spam or not. So the final step will be making some prediction. However, you have to remember one point. Whenever I am talking about regression, regression is also a classical example of supervised learning algorithm, which is also used for prediction. And classification algorithms are also used for prediction. So the only difference is what we are going to predict. If we are going to predict some discrete value like this, then we have to implement classification algorithm, or if we are going to predict some age, salary or something like that, then we have to use that regression value. So in this case, what we are going to predict in case of Irish dataset, we know that in Irish dataset, we have to predict the type of the flower or the species, Cetrosa versicolor or virginica, and we know that this kind of values are discrete values. So therefore, we are using classification algorithms, right? So now I will discuss the most important part and the technical details. Let's see the code. So here, this part I have already explained. So what is this part? So what happens is scikit-learn will work if the data is stored as numeric data, means irrespective of it being a regression or classification problem. So this feature is already known to us. If some data set are already there in scikit-learn, we can use them for our prediction purpose. whether it doesn't matter whether I'm using it for regression or whether I'm using it for classification. So here I'm using this dataset IDISH for classification purpose. So this is the very first step, so we have to remember. Now we have to understand another point. What is that point? So always you find me writing this kind of statements. To understand this statement, I will explain it one by one. So now, whenever you find me writing that from sklearn, then import dataset or datasets. So we know that what is the meaning of this line, and we know that after that we have to take one variable where we are going to load the data sets. So for loading purpose, the command is load then the dataset name. Now see here, we have this two line immediately after this, x equal to irish.data and y equal to irish.target. Now you have to understand this point. So here x contains the features and y contains the labels or the class label. So I have already explained that whenever we are dealing with some machine learning data, this machine learning data will have its own features. So for in case of IRISH, we have petal length, petal width, sepal length and sepal width, and we have one class level which is known as variety or species, right? So here my point is Y contains target. Target means the class level, and X is containing the data, means X will contain the feature. So this is how we have to create, always we have to create two variables, X and Y. One is responsible for holding the feature and another is responsible for holding the class labels. Now the question is why? So I have explained that the main purpose of this classification algorithm is to train the machine first and then perform testing on that. So training of a particular machine requires input features and as well as class level, both. So therefore we have to use X and Y variable both for training purpose. Now see here, so after that you find me writing this line from sklearn.model selection import train underscore test underscore split.
Ma'am, here it is written load underscore iris. So it is loading directly from the UCI machine repository or?
No. I have explained that scikit-learn. So I am using here the scikit-learn repository, means scikit-learn data set. If you don't want this, so what you can do, we know that first we can fetch the data set, then we have to store this data set in the CSV file, and here we can write read underscore CSV. That thing also work. So instead of writing this line, you can just write read underscore CSV in order to read your own CSV file and store it in this variable. So any of the approach you can use, right? But whatever may be your approach, the first step of the classification algorithm is you have to take two variables. One variable is used for features and another variable is used for holding the class level. So now see here, there in this line, it is clearly mentioned that I am splitting something, split. So since our process involves training and testing, so it is important to split our data set. So and it will be executed by this lines. Now what is the meaning of splitting? Let me explain this one first, then I will tell you that what is the meaning of this 0.5 size and everything. So these two lines are very much important. So now what do you mean by splitting? So try to remember this point Whenever I am dealing with IRIS dataset, I have explained that how many instances we have. We have 150 instances, right? Means 150 number of samples. So splitting means what will happen? We will split our data set into two halves. One part will contain training data set and another part will contain testing data set. Now here the first question is, what is the percentage of splitting? So in general, try to remember the first concept you have to learn while splitting. You have to remember the point, that is, training sample or training instance will be greater than testing instance, training sample. Why? Because always human being also, to learn, it will read more data, and for testing it will need few data. In your examination, what will happen? You will study a lot, means you train your brain with lots of information about a particular subject, but in exam you will get very few questions from that particular chapter of that specific subject, right? So in general, this is the first notion you have to follow. Always the size of the training sample will be greater than the size of the testing sample. Now the second point, what is the percentage? So in general, it is a good practice in machine learning, we will use this percentage, 70%, 30%. Some people will use 80%, 20%, or some people you will use 90%, 10%. Means these are the size of the training sample and these are the size of the testing sample. So in general, these two cases are very often. So always you will find that you are splitting your data set into some percentage into training and testing data. And also you have to remember one point, that is, your testing data will contain feature and class level both. But one thing you have to state, that you cannot write it like this. You are taking 30% as training data and you are taking 70% data as testing. It is not possible because it will degrade your accuracy. But I cannot state that if the accuracy, means if the size of the training sample increases, means instead of 70, if you take 80 or 90, then accuracy will also increase. No, we cannot state that. So it is a empirical analysis. Now you can ask me one question. Okay, madam, you tell me one thing, that is, which percentage should I take? Actually, we don't know. It's a trial and error method. So this is the first point of research. So whenever you are working on some data, you just take this one and test the accuracy of the algorithm. Then split your data set into this part, then try to check the accuracy. So whichever splitting is giving more accuracy, it means this data set works fine with that specific value, right? Then also we have another concept of overfitting and underfitting. I will tell you later on. Okay. So the reverse you cannot take. So this thing you have to follow. But one thing here, now try to understand what we are doing in this code. See, these two lines, these two highlighted lines will represent the same concept. Now what will happen? Here, say you find me writing X-train. So this X-train contains the training features. Means sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal length, petal width of the training samples. Say out of 150 sample, if I have selected 70% of sample as training data set, among that training data set, 4 features will be selected as X-train. So that's why X-train contains the training features. Now we have X-test. X-test contains the testing features. So the rest of the part, which is not selected as a training data set, so that part also will have two segment, features and class level. So the testing features will be kept here in X test. Now you will be able to understand what do you mean by Y train and Y test. Here Y train contains the training level And Y test contain the testing levels. Means here it will hold the species, the class species that they are holding. Right? So here try to understand, after fetching the data set, you have to create two variables in order to separate features and class level for the entire data set. And then you have to perform training and test splitting. Now don't understand this concept as model building. So this is not a part of model building step. This step is the additional step that you have to perform immediately after data set fetching. This is not about your model building. Model building is something else. Now here you will find me writing test size is 0.5. Means test sample size is 0.5. Can anyone tell that what is the meaning of 0.5? Yes, exactly, half of the actual data. So here basically 50% data I have used for an out of 150, 50% data I am using for training and 50% data I am using for testing. It is a very unlikely situation. So what you have to do, the first point that you have to perform here, you have to change the size. Means if you are writing here 0.3, it means what? Can anyone state? If I write here instead of 5.5, if I write 0.3, 50%, then definitely the training data will be 70%. So it is a very likely situation, because these are the cases, case 1, case 2 and case 3. If the testing data is 30%, then definitely the training data will be 70%. So automatically this portion will be reached. So here it is very unlikely situation, because at this point of time it may hamper the accuracy, because here training and testing sample size is equal. So, and according to my discussion, we should always keep more training data rather than testing data. It will help us to improve the accuracy. But why I am doing this? Because it is your test case. Means, actually I will tell you why I am doing this, because I want to show you something, that in some cases people will prefer to use equal amount of training data and equal amount of testing data, right? So this convention is also applicable, but unfortunately, so there is no rule, but unfortunately it is a proven fact that whenever we are working on really huge real life data, then at this point of time 70% and 30% will work better. So that's why I'm giving you this case study. You just change the value. See, we can do it. Means we can also write over here 0.9. Means 90% data is for testing and 10% data is for training. You can write it also. But you have to check the accuracy, what you are getting as an output. So this is the self-study. Then you will realize why I have stated that 70%, 30% is one of the better option. See, since we are talking about machine learning, there is no such fixed rule. It is a soft computing technique. But why I am writing it 0.5? Because in some cases, you can, for research purpose, you can put equal number of training data and testing data. But it is a great risk, because accuracy may hamper, right? So now you have to find out in which situation you are getting what. Okay, so that's why these two lines are very much important. So I've explained this one. Now we will talk about the second step, that is model building. That what do you mean by model building? See here, what we are doing, we are using classification algorithm to solve the problem. Means we are going to solve the problem of species detection. So we have already considered one algorithm, that is the decision tree classifier algorithm, as our supervised classification algorithm. So at the beginning of this class, I have already explained that today we are going to talk about decision tree classifier and k-nearest neighbor classifier. And also I have explained one more point. Whatever algorithm we are talking about, each and every algorithm is already written in Python. We have to just call the algorithm. Now Today, I'm not talking about the technical details or the internal details of the decision tree classifier. I will explain it later on. So I'm just talking about the implementation details. So model building means here you have to write which algorithm you are going to implement. So here I'm going to implement decision tree classifier. And see, you have to remember one point. Whenever you are dealing with any object-oriented programming, and if that object-oriented programming is fetching some predefined method, and if that predefined method, if the method is comprises of more than one word, all the word will start with capital letter. But in case of Java, what happens if the predefined method is already comprises of many words, then the first letter starts with small lowercase and rest of the letter, means starting letter of the next word, will be starting with the uppercase. So this is the general convention that we are going to use. So here basically we are calling the decision tree algorithm and we are storing this called method inside this classifier, right? So this is, so whenever you are calling any particular algorithm to serve any purpose, so here our purpose is classification applied on iris data, so this part is known as model building part, right? And now here, if you are going to write k nearest neighbor algorithm, so instead of writing this part, you have to write, that is neighbors.kneighbor classifier. So these are the thing that we have to change later on. So this is the model building part. Now we have to go to the third step, which is known as training part. But at this point of time, at this point we have just made a model, means up to this line, starting from this up to this time we have just made a model, but it cannot able to predict whether a given flower belongs to which species of iris. So if our model has to predict the flower, so we have to train our model with the features and as well as class level both. So from this line onwards we are moving to the third step, which is known as training the model. So here we can train the model with fit function. So whenever you find me writing fit function, you will be able to understand that I'm going to train the model. So please make a note, in machine learning, fit function is used to train the model. Now I'm going to train which one? I'm going to train with the decision tree classification algorithm, and which is stored, and after calling this algorithm, it is stored in classifier. So this fit function is called on the variable classifier, right? And here see, we have X train and Y train. So what is the meaning of X train and Y train? I have already explained, right? X train is the features for training and Y train is the class level that is used for training purpose. So this is all about the third step, which is used for train the model. Now the final step. What is that final step? This final step is used for prediction, right? Now prediction is the most important point that you have to realize. So here the prediction can be matched with the expected output, right? To measure the accuracy value. This is the most important thing that you have to understand. See, what is this prediction is all about? See, whenever I am talking about training, I am considering the feature and I am considering the class level. But whenever I am performing testing, though I have considered these features and the class level both, but while measuring accuracy, we will only give the machine the features from the testing samples. So after getting the feature, it will give us some output on the basis of these features. So now the next step is we will compare this output from the sorry, we will compare this output with the existing class level which exists in the testing part. So this comparison will give us the accuracy check. So that's why I was talking about the prediction is all about matching. Matching with this is the expected output that is already there, and this is the measured accuracy that we are giving. So, this is the predicted output and this is the expected output. So, matching these two things will give us the accuracy value. Now, check here. So, that's why in the prediction, we have used X test parameter only, means X test variable only. X test variable means what? I have already explained. This X test will contain the features of the training samples. So I am not considering Y test because this Y test will be used while measuring the accuracy score. So whatever is the Y test value is already there in the original data set. I will compare whatever is my prediction score. So whatever this machine has predicted using testing data, it is stored in this prediction variable. So accuracy measurement is nothing but comparing the actual outcome, means actual class level that exists in the training set, and whatever the machine has predicted. So comparing these two will give us the prediction accuracy. And see, here we have got the prediction accuracy 0.94666. Means this is a huge accuracy that we have achieved. Means 94% species, this decision tree classifier will able to identify properly. Now check one thing. So whenever we have this kind of algorithm executed, so what will happen, whether this accuracy changes or not? This is the most important thing that you have to realize. So whenever you execute this algorithm for the first time, you may find that this accuracy value is oscillating. But at one point of time, you will find that these values remain fixed. So whatever value I have get in the previous iteration, I have get the same accuracy value over here. So it means the algorithm converges. So here using decision tree algorithm, we have got the accuracy of 0.9466%, means more than 94%. So it's a quite good accuracy, right? So we can say it as 95% almost. Anyways, so this is the accuracy which is achieved by decision tree classifier. But in the previous class, I have already explained that our main intention is to use different kinds of classification algorithms. Why? So that we could compare the accuracy of the algorithm achieved. So now see here. Here the accuracy achieved on the same data set, IRISH, using decision tree classifier is 94%. That is 0.9466%. And I have executed this code repeated number of times, I am getting this percentage. So this percentage is neither increasing or not decreasing. However, in this case, the data set is same. This splitting portion that I have already explained, they are same. And here also I have taken 50% data for training and 50% data for testing. What is the difference? So the only difference that is created by me over here is the classification algorithm. So I have completely changed this classification algorithm from decision tree to k nearest neighbor classification algorithm. And see, without changing anything on the same data, I am getting 98% accuracy. It is 0.98666. This is the amount of accuracy that I am achieving. So at this point of time, I can conclude that for IRISH dataset, for classification purpose, the k nearest neighbor algorithm performs better than decision tree classification algorithm. So this is the first conclusion that I can assert at this point of time. But can I guarantee it? So, I have already explained that decision tree or k-nearest neighbor algorithm and their performance will vary data to data. Means you cannot conclude that, okay, we have understood this concept, so it means k-nearest neighbor algorithm is better than decision tree classifier. No, you cannot conclude that. K-nearest neighbor algorithm is better for iris classification purpose than decision tree. It is not for, you cannot conclude it generally as a general purpose. In some data sets, say you are working on cancer data set classification, I don't know, if you apply this to algorithms, then you will find that which algorithm is giving you the better result. This is the first point. Now I'm going to state you the second most important point. Let's talk about the data split. So here I have made one really very unconventional process that I have taken 50% data for training and 50% data for testing. This kind of convention basically don't work. Means in real life, researchers use the splitting as 70% 30% or 80% 20%. This is the most common splitting that we have to use. Now you have to check one more point. So whenever you are executing is your algorithm for 70% and 30% training and testing and 80% and 20% for training and testing, what are the accuracy measurement it is providing, right? You have to observe, means whether it is oscillating or not, means whenever you are changing this value, first check for the decision tree classifier whether they are changing or not. Now check, what if the same thing, if you change this value, now this accuracy oscillates or not. Now at this point of time, you have compared between two. Means whenever 70%, 30% splits are there for both the algorithms, then what are the accuracy you are achieving? Then you have to test for 80% and 20%. Then you have to check what is the percentage of accuracy and then for 90% and 10%. So if for all cases, your k-nearest neighbor algorithm is giving the best outcome or better outcome than decision tree classifier, then only you can state that k-nearest neighbor algorithm works better than decision tree on iris dataset in case of classification. So this is the very first conclusion that I am going to state. So you have to change the sites for both the algorithm, and then you have to track the accuracy, and then you have to compare. So whenever you are writing here 0.3, it means 70% and 30% splits are there, execute this algorithm. You will get some accuracy. Now put here 0.3. So you will get some accuracy. So now compare these two accuracy. First you have to check whether this accuracy is changing or not, changing it from 0.5 to 0.3. Now then you have to check whether this accuracy is changing or not, and then you have to check which one is better. It may happen after writing 0.3 over here, this accuracy may fall. I don't know, but you have to check. So you have to check for 70%, 30%, 80%, 20% and 90%, 10%. If all the cases you will get better result, better accuracy in case of KNN, then only finally you can conclude that for classification algorithm on iris dataset, k-nearest neighbor classifier works better than decision tree. Otherwise, by visualizing one output, if you conclude this one, it is not a good choice. So this kind of empirical analysis you have to make, right? So you can work lots on this, but as I have promised in the previous class, that is, whenever we are going to implement any kind of classification with any kind of algorithm, Python give us the method and we don't have to write this method from scratch, right? So this is our first conclusion for today's session. Now I am going to show you one more code, then you will be able to understand. See, whenever I was discussing clustering concept in the last day session, so many of you posted me some algorithm that is designed by you for k-means clustering, and all of those codings are perfectly working well, right? So it means whichever algorithm we are writing or imposing over here, we can change this one, means whatever code I am writing for implementing k nearest neighbor classification, we can change this code a little bit. Now the question is why? Because you have maintained all the steps. See, it depends on the requirement, what I am going to do. See, here my point is, here I am going to see the outcome or the prediction outcome. But it may happen my requirement is something else. What is that requirement? See here. So I have designed the same k nearest neighbor algorithm with another approach. What is that approach? See here. First thing that I have changed is that I haven't used the basic IRIS dataset. So whatever we have in our scikit-learn repository. So now if I am using my own dataset, what may happen? This thing you have to track. You have to be very cautious. See here, I am using one data set which is known as irish1.csv and it is in my D drive. Let me check. See, I'm talking about this file. So basically my point is I'm going to use my own data set. So this is the data set that I am going to use. See this one. Now I know that in scikit-learn, what is the configuration of the data set? I'm not be able to visualize since I'm working on my own data set. I have found that instead of features, we have some one particular extra column which contains ID. Right? So it contains some numbering. So basically this column is very much unnecessary. So this column is not required. But it may happen, what I'm going to state, whenever we are dealing with raw data, it may happen that there exist some columns which are not at all necessary. So what happens? So here I'm reading the CSV file, fine. And I'm storing this into IRIS variable. So instead of writing load function. And then see, I have created one mechanism over here to drop the ID column. Now I will ask you one question. Can anyone state what this mechanism is all about?
Ma'am, slicing is used here, ma'am.
Thank you, Devargo. Yes, see, you have asked me this question that why we are learning ILOC or slicing. See, whenever in your raw data set you have any unnecessary column attached with it, at this point of time, we will use the concept of slicing or ILOC function. So here I have removed that column, which is known as ID column. So try to understand what is my second conclusion. The second conclusion is, whatever data you are fetching from the repository, if you are going to use those data directly by load function, it may happen that you just have to follow these four steps of classification and you are ready with the outcome. But in real life, you need to process the data, and the most important thing is this dropping of ID is mandatory, you can say. So if you check, you go and UCI machine learning, and if you open the COCS liver disease or cancer disease, this kind of disease data, if you open, you have many kind of unnecessary columns. So you have to drop those columns in order to create a good data set. So it's a part of data processing. They are not a part of classification algorithm. Remember this point. So here I have stated that after fetching the data, you have to perform some steps which are not at all part of model building. So these are the part of data processing. So data splitting and dropping unnecessary columns will come under this one, will come under data processing part. So after that, now you are ready, and see here what I have done. I have taken this 0.3% data, right? Here testing data size is 0.3, means 70% data I have used for testing. So this is how you can explore this one. So I have printed many things. Why I have printed this thing, you have to explore. Now the next thing, then we have to, the next step is we have to create the classifier. And see, here I have used one line. This is the most important concept that I am going to explain later. See, in case of k nearest neighbor classifier, since we have neighboring concept, so whenever I'm going to explain this algorithm, you have to find out that you will find one concept, that what is the number of neighbors, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, what is the number? Again, it is a great concern. We don't know what should be the number of neighbor. So try to understand the same algorithm I have used, and here I have just called the k nearest neighbor classifier without mentioning any neighboring value. So, and in the next code, same algorithm I have used, and I have mentioned the neighboring value. So from here, the third conclusion we can achieve. Whenever we are using any algorithm in Python, it is mandatory to know the exact mathematical explanation of this algorithm. Since we don't know what do you mean by k nearest neighbor algorithm and what is the mathematics, so at this point of time, why I am setting this neighbor value as 5 and why in the in this code I am not mentioning the neighbor value, here I am leaving the space as vacant, why, you will not be able to understand. So the third conclusion is, calling a function is very easy, but it is very difficult to understand the output. Whatever may be the scenario, up to this you can understand that, okay, whatever I have written over here, it is a model building concept. Fine. So here I am going to build a classification model, and you know that I am not using decision tree because k nearest neighbor is giving me better performance. So that's why I am just implementing k nearest neighbor, but you can use decision tree here also. So now the next step, I am using fit function. And fit function is used on which variable? I have explained that whenever you are calling any classification algorithm, this called function must be stored inside a variable. And this variable will be used to call the fit function. So fit function is used to train the model. So I'm taking xtrain features and ytrain are the class levels. So then the last step is we have to predict. So same thing I have used. So here in case of prediction, see the code. Here I have written this variable knn.predict xtest only. And I have printed ypredict, right? So actually I have printed what you have to explain. Can anyone explain? Here I am printing what? I'm not going to show you the output. Predicting means comparing the expected output and the actual output. My first question is, am I comparing anything over here so that I could find out the accuracy? Yes or no? What I am doing here? Just observe this line and tell me. Here what I am doing. I am predicting on xtest. Xtest is what? More precisely, it is testing data. We know that. Xtest means what? Testing data has two parts. Features.
Class features.
Levels. Yes.
Features of the testing data.
Yes. And what I am printing over here now, tell me.
The class level of the predicted data.
Testing data. Right?
Testing.
So here, what is the purpose of my algorithm? Here, this algorithm is meant to see the responses. Responses means what? It is giving us the output, whatever thing is predicted by the system. So here I am going to display all the predicted outcome by the system. So these are the class level of the testing data set that I am getting. Now this data set, I have to compare it with my actual data set. Right? So here also my last conclusion over here is, you can design a classification algorithm in order to show the responses also. So now it is up to you. Now you know that how you could deal with this algorithm. See, whenever you are getting the responses, see, visually it is okay. So I'm getting this kind of responses, then I can go and check. But it is really very difficult. So it is better immediately after writing these responses, means printing these responses, then it is better to write this code, so that it could automatically compare whatever response you have got and whatever value is there in your algorithm. So what I am going to conclude is that this is known as predicted outcome, right? And whatever we have in our data set, it is the expected outcome. So accuracy means comparing between these two. So here accuracy is 98%, means only two class level it has misclassified. 94% means it has misclassified six values. So this is how this is the actual meaning of this accuracy measurement. So I expect that you could explore this two classification algorithms for some new data set. So for the beginning, what I will suggest, you just load any data set from sklearn, any data set. You go and check what data set you have in sklearn. You try to explore all the data sets. You have cancer data, everything. There are preloaded data, so you can use them. And then try to compare these two algorithms. So can I expect this one from you, that you could explore and compare these two algorithms and give me some result? Now the fifth conclusion. So I have covered a pretty good amount of algorithm in machine learning. Now here is, if this is your research work, see, Irish is your data set, and I have given you one topic that we are performing supervised classification, right? Now I want to write one paper. So how you could write the paper? Now I am telling you that approach. So whenever you have the data set, and whenever you have in your mind what you are going to perform, you are going to perform supervised classification. Fine. Now the paper means now you can put your own effort. Now how you can put your own effort? Now this is the place you have to understand. So first thing is, without writing the code for classification directly, first thing you can do, you can explore the data set. Means you have to write the codes for understanding your data set, that is the data analysis part. Skew analysis, Kurth analysis, pair plot, correlation plot, histogram plot, everything, univariate analysis you can perform on your data set. So this is the first approach. Now for research, what we will do, we actually take more than two data sets. Say I'm taking Irish data set, I'm taking another flower data set, say flower set number two, and I'm taking another. So three means we have to fetch the data set in such a manner that they belongs to the same category, life science category. So we are taking three different kinds of flower data set from UCI Learning, and we are performing data analysis on all of those data sets first. So after analyzing all those data set, we will find our first research analysis, first research output. What is that output? The first research output is which data set is more difficult to deal with. Because whenever you are performing pair plot, correlation analysis, then you will find some inside statistics, skew analysis, then you will find that which features are really difficult to understand. So this is the first thing you will get from the data analysis. The second thing, you can get what amount of feature you are having and which features are necessary and which features are not necessary. Then you have to pre-process the data. That is, you have to drop some of the columns. So now you can get your second conclusion, that in which data set we need dropping of column action and in which data set it is not required. So whichever data set does not require any dropping action means that data set is the cleanest data set among this remaining two data set. So second conclusion you have got. Now you have to find out the data split portion. Now you create one table where you just write four test cases, 50%, 50% training testing split, then 70-30, 80-20 and 90-10, and then fill up this table using different classification algorithm and try to find out in maximum cases for three different data set which algorithm is performing better. So what is our final conclusion? So whenever you have this kind of situation that you have performed all the test cases that I have mentioned in order to compare decision tree classifier and k-nearest neighbor classifier, and after performing all the test cases, changing the training testing data set size, dropping up of the column, then you will get that k-nearest neighbor is performing better than decision tree for IDIS data set. But here also you cannot conclude that k-nearest neighbor is better for flower classification. Now you have to perform the same analysis repeatedly for other two data sets also, other two flower data sets also. If for three data sets, in maximum cases, k-nearest neighbor is performing better than decision tree, then in your research paper, you can conclude that k-nearest neighbor algorithm is good or is better for life science flower analysis purpose. Otherwise, you cannot conclude. So using one data set is another bad approach. So this is how you have to write your research paper. So this is the approach that you have to follow. So it is not so easy, right? And finally, you have one more approach. So whenever you are using k-nearest neighbor algorithm, then you have to show if you are running this algorithm, then there is a question, what is the neighbor value? And if you are writing this algorithm, then I will definitely ask you this question. That is, why it is set as 5? Why not 1, 2, 3 and 4? So this is another statistical analysis that you have to put in your paper. That is, I am taking neighbor value as 4 for IDIS dataset. So now after putting neighbor value as 4 for IDIS dataset, you have to check same thing for other two datasets also. So whenever the neighbor value is 4, what is the accuracy score you are getting? Then you have to check for 5. It is better if you check for 3. So now you have another statistical analysis that if you change the neighbor value, then what will happen? And which neighbor value is the best for your data set? Means here I have written 5. It does not imply that 5 is the best option for IDIS data set. I haven't tested it. I have arbitrarily written it as 5. So you have to check this one also. So again, you have to make one statistical table where you have to put different neighbor values and you have to check the accuracy score. Means whether the changing neighbor values is affecting the accuracy or not. So this is how your research paper will be written. Right? And more the analysis you are giving, better your research paper will be. So whenever your research paper is reviewed, the reviewer will check all this criteria. The testing sample size, how many data set you have used, what are the insight of those data sets, means the data analysis part. And then whenever you are using unsupervised learning, what is the value of k? Whenever you are using k nearest neighbor, so what is the neighboring value? So these are the analysis you have to put in your paper. If all analyses are there, then your paper is ready to publish and they will accept your paper, right? So these are the approach. So writing code is very easy, but finding what are the statistical analysis you will put in your paper, it is completely depends on you. That's why researcher to researcher, the paper varies, because it is the researcher's mind who will decide how I will represent my paper. Just writing classification algorithm and comparing the accuracy won't work. So you have to prove one general conclusion. So these are the approach you have to keep in mind. So here I am stating all those approaches, but it may happen if you are working on some different mechanism. So at that point of time, you have to think what are the comparison parameter that we are going to put into it, right? So this is how your research paper is written. So today we have already completed classification algorithms also, and we have so many other algorithms. You can go and test those algorithms because you have to just call the functions. For this part you have to know. Then you can compare all those classification algorithms. Now you can select data from UCI, whether you want to work on medical data, whether you want to work on Amazon data, anything, on anything you can work, no issues. So I need a very good statistics, right?